This video is about an introduction, very short introduction to OpenFOAM, which is an open source CFD or computational fluid dynamics software. What is OpenFOAM? OpenFOAM stands for open source field operation and manipulation. Although we are using OpenFOAM for CFD, OpenFOAM software can solve any set of field equations. Field equations could be velocity, temperature, concentration, electromagnetic field, any other field that you have a equation for. Most common things that are solved are Navier-Stokes equation, energy and temperature, diffusion plus reaction, and electromagnetics. It uses a method, numerical method, known as the finite volume method. You don't have to know the details of this now, but just good to know that you will be coming across this FV term at many places. So it essentially means it's a finite volume. The other commonly used method is called as a finite element method. This OpenFOAM uses a finite volume method. OpenFOAM is very powerful tool. It's open source. So many people around the world have contributed to this, and it's becoming increasingly popular now. But it is not so convenient that it is not like a graphic user interface driven like many other softwares you might have seen or get to know in future. But it is based on a text or coding based approach. It's almost like writing a small pseudocode. So OpenFOAM was originally from this foundation called as CFD Direct. And these are two important resources that you should be using for getting to know about OpenFOAM. CFD Direct's OpenFOAM tutorial guide, which user guide, which has got a tutorial, and IIT Bombay's own spoken tutorial, which has got a OpenFOAM for version 7. Many of these things you will come across in the tutorials. However, here we just point out very briefly the important aspects so that you can concentrate on that and think about it in a global form. OpenFOAM, as I said, is completely file and folder driven. There is no graphic user interface. So each problem is called as a case, and each case has its own directory. So in this case, the name of the case is cavity. So the problem's name is cavity. So then this is the folder. So what you see in blue here is a folder. This is a folder. This is a folder. Or in Unix, it is called as a directory. So these are all directories, and these are all the ones in black are all files. So directories and files. So under this case folder, we have various other folders which contain most of the important information. Let's see what they are. So this top level is the name of the case, which is the parent directory. Inside that, the one level contains physical constants. So anything that's related to the physics of the problem is what we call as physical constants. It could be like geometry, it could be physical properties, viscosity, thermal conductivity, and so on. These are all called physical constants. That also defines the geometry. So geometry means, remember that it contains a mesh. So you need to define the mesh. That is also defined within this folder called constant, directory called constant. Then there could be properties. So all the physical properties. In this case, it is just called transport properties, but you could have other thermodynamic properties as well. Then you have directories named by numbers. So zero is a particular time instance. So 0 represents the initial condition. P and U are the variables that we are solving for. P is for pressure in this case, U is velocity. So P and U are the values of P and U at 0. So this folder 0 represents the initial condition. And the boundary condition for pressure and velocity are described inside this file, P for pressure boundary condition and U for velocity boundary condition. Both initial condition and boundary conditions are specified within this P and U files. Then comes computational parameters. So there is physical parameters, then computational parameters. What are computational parameters? Computational parameters are things which are related to the solver. So how do you want the schemes? Schemes is first of all the discretization scheme. So you have different ways of discretizing differential operator, second order differential operator, what kind of method you're going to use to discretize. So those are specified here. So these are all related to the computation aspect. This is a numerical approximation that we are making. And then what method you are using? Are you using Gauss-Seidel or some other solution that method that you're going to solve, use to solve? So this is system means it is usually containing computational parameters, and the constant folder contains the physical parameters. Inside all these files, as I told you, it looks like a small C program. The syntax is very similar to a C++ syntax. Every statement has to end with a semicolon. So this is not a full-fledged C program, but the syntax looks very similar. All the parameters, usually the files are called as specification files. All the parameters are represented in what is known as a dictionary object. A dictionary object means a key and a value. It's in many programming languages, you might have heard of key value pairs. People who are familiar with Python will immediately recognize what a dictionary is. So dictionary is an object whose value is identified by a name. That name is called as a key. So these keys could be scalar or an array. So in this case, this is the key, and this value is the value that this takes. So type equal to fixed value and the value equal to this. Here you notice is slightly different from the way this is written. Scalars are written as plain, just like that, followed by a semicolon, end of the sentence, end of the statement. Arrays are written by round brackets. So 100 represents X, Y, and Z in this case. So there are just three components of an array. So arrays are represented by round brackets. These could be nested inside what is known as dictionaries. And dictionaries are themselves represented by curly brackets. So for example, these two values are inside what is known as a dictionary called as moving wall. So the moving wall dictionary has two elements, two entities to it, type and value. So if you're familiar with object-oriented programming, you will immediately recognize you can write it as moving wall dot type has a value, fixed value. Moving wall dot value has a value, uniform 100. Now this dictionary object can be nested one above the other. So if you want to think of this as an object or a class, it's very similar to a C++ or a Python class where you have this object is an object inside a bigger object. So which is again denoted by a curly bracket here. Dimensional units are denoted by square brackets. So nu, which is the kinematic viscosity, has a dimension of this array and a value of 0.01. So what does this array mean? This array stands for mass, length, and time. Then temperature. You have seven elements here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So mass, length, time, temperature, quantity, which is usually mole, current, and luminous intensity. In SI units, this will be kilograms, meters, second, Kelvin, mole, ampere, and candela. So for nu, which has got a units of meters square per second, this is m0, l power minus 2, t power minus 1, and rest all is 0. And nu has a value 0.01. So it is same as this, except that we have introduced, if you just say nu equal to 0.01, you will not have any meaning to this. So you say nu with this dimension has a value 0.1. Let us look at the broad steps that you will be following. If you follow the tutorial, this is the exact thing that you will be following. What we have done here is to extract the key steps so that you are in phase, you have a synchronization with what is done in a big picture format. Most of OpenFOAM cases, the way you solve it is to not start from scratch, but you start from a known example. So you look up at the closest example, which is using the similar physics and possibly a similar geometry. So the first step that you do in most OpenFOAM tutorials and even in real life problems is to copy an example case. So there are several cases that are given in the tutorials folder. One of them you copy to your directory and then modify the geometry. So once you modify the geometry, again, that has to be done by hand. Once you modify the geometry, you visualize it. And we'll talk about how to visualization in a separate video, but we'll be using briefly something known as ParaView. So as soon as you modify, you make sure what you modified is right and then display it. So here we have the object that is displayed. You can display the axis so you know the dimensions are all correct as you intended in the geometry. And then create the mesh, that is the discretization in X and Y direction. So in this case, we have created the mesh and then view the mesh. Again, go back to ParaView and view the mesh. So once the mesh is done, now you have to set the physical constant. So you might have to set the thermal conductivity or the viscosity, and then boundary conditions and initial conditions, the different folders that are there. So always think about these steps when you're following the tutorials. So you have these steps, first setting the physical parameters, then setting the computational parameters. Computational parameters essentially means till how much time you want to solve, when do you want to stop, how frequently you want data to be returned to disk, and what discretization scheme you must use. Discretization is for the differential operators, and what solver methods, what is the tolerance, and so on. So physical, then computational, then finally run the solver. If everything goes on fine, you will get results. Then look whether the results are converged. If they are not converged, you might have to go and change something here in the numerical parameters, and then view the results. So for scalar quantities, typically we plot what is known as this two-dimensional contours. So red represents high pressure and blue represents low pressure and so on. So see if it makes sense. For vector quantities, you can use things like what's this vector plot, which shows the local direction of the velocity vector. So you can see whether it makes sense. So once you get something working, because this is all coding, and just as in any code, you can have bugs, syntax errors, and all those things will make it a little difficult, steep learning curve. But once you are through that, the good a good practice is start with a simple case. Don't increase, don't have large number of mesh because it just takes long time to solve. Start with something which you can solve quickly and make sure everything works. Still this you get, even if it's an approximate solution that doesn't make sense, it's okay. But try to get one output here. So once you have established a workflow from here to here, now you are confident that it will work. Then you can go and refine your mesh. You can refine your computational parameters and then get a better solution. The problem that you will be doing in tutorials is called as lid-driven cavity flow. This is a canonical test case that is used as a benchmark for all incompressible flow. So I will give you a brief introduction to this flow so that when you're doing the problem, you're also in sync with what the actual problem is being solved and why you're solving it. So here we have a cavity. So this is a three-dimensional cavity, but for the purpose of numerical computation, it is taken only in 2D. 2D in the sense, the flow is in 2D. Flow is not in 3D. The cavity might be 3D, but in this direction, there is no flow. There is a Z component of velocity is not there. It's only X and Y component of the velocity. So it's a two-dimensional flow. So you have a liquid in a two-dimensional cavity and the top is open. All the sides are walls and the top is open. On the top, we also have a lid which is placed over this cavity and the lid is moving in this direction. So moving lid and cavity containing liquid. So that is lid is driving the flow inside the cavity. That's why it's called as a lid-driven cavity flow. So lid-driven cavity flow is a standard benchmark tool. So if you are able to simulate this and get the known results, then you can be confident that the methods that you followed for discretization, the numerical approximation that you're doing are correct. So why study this lid-driven cavity flow? Because although the geometry is simple, it can lead to a lot of complex motions of the, you can get complex patterns of motion. So if you compare in a simple case, Reynolds number equal to 100, you will see this vortices. So these are all vortices. So because the flow is in this direction, you notice that this is not exactly in the center, but slightly shifted towards the right. Suppose you had done the same thing at a Reynolds number less than 1, then you will have exactly symmetrical flow. You will not have this asymmetry. So you from Reynolds number equal to less than 1, you can go to any Reynolds number and the pattern is so very different. So this a simple object such as this lid driving this flow in a cavity can lead to complex structures just in the main vortex itself. Apart from this, there are also this secondary vortices. They're called as corner vortices. So this corner vortex rotates in this direction and the corner vortex will rotate in the anti-clockwise direction. Similarly, this will rotate in the anti-clockwise direction. The location of and the shape and the number of this vortices. So here we have 1, 2, 3 vortices. Here also we have 3 vortices. As we increase Reynolds number, you see it, this one gets pulled to this side and a third vortex comes here. Not only there, but you have 2 more vortices coming here. So the number of vortices, the location of the vortex and the shape of vortex are all well-studied problems. So if you set up an OpenFOAM problem and you are able to compare these your result with known results of the number, shape, and location, then you can be confident that you have set up the problem correctly. So as an exercise for CFD using OpenFOAM, this is what is our suggestion. As a beginner, just follow the tutorials given in section 2.1. Just section 2.1 is sufficient. That involves refining mesh, plotting the results in ParaView, as well as changing the Reynolds number. So if you can do this, you can you will be familiar with the workflow of OpenFOAM, and then you can start solving other problems in, say, temperature or concentration profiles. For an intermediate user, if you're expecting to do a project for, say, 6 months to a year or so, you need to go one step further. What you need to do is not only just do plots, but also compare those plots with what is available in literature for these different Reynolds numbers. So it's known, the location, number, and shape is known. So you have to compare. For an advanced user, you have to do for intermediate is to use block mesh. Remember, we discussed about block mesh in OpenFOAM tutorials, introduction. So you have different regions having different resolutions of mesh size. So in spoken tutorials, you'll have, there's a tutorial on how to generate block mesh. So you can use that to refine your mesh, not only in one domain, but in multiple domains. For an advanced user, I mean that you expect to work on a problem for on CFD and OpenFOAM for 1 year or more, then you have to look at seeing various solvers, various discretization schemes, various relaxation parameters, how they influence the results that you got. So as a start, go through this OpenFOAM user guide, which contains tutorials, and do tutorials to section 2.1.
You can find more case studies in FOSSI's CFD case study project, which is an initiative of IIT Bombay. Here you can download, learn, and submit your own case studies.